Welcome home, church. Well, good morning, everyone. So glad that you're here today. We got some really neat stuff planned for service today. I think it'll be very enjoyable for you. I know it will be for us. The worship team's worked hard on some new material this morning, and so if it doesn't go as planned, just grace, right? We're a church that believes in grace. Amen. So just a little disclaimer right there. Well, if you're a visitor today, we've got these welcome cards in front of you. If you want to fill that out, we keep your information private, and we'd like to send you a welcome card. Who knows, you might even get a Marie Callender's pot pie out of it. Now, I know they're frozen, you know, because they, but no, we're so glad that you're here. We hope that you feel welcome and that you have a real engagement with the Lord this morning. We come here to fellowship with one another, but first and foremost, we come here to preach the word, to worship our Lord, and to be in his presence together as the church. Amen? And that's what this meeting is about. And so, you know, I got a quick video I want to show, but I want to just real quick, some of you may or may not know how the process of credentialing works in our church. We are a part of the Church of the Nazarene. We're part of a denomination that was founded a little over 100 years ago. Our theology is Wesleyan-based, and there's more information in the foyer if you want to know more about our doctrine, but we believe in the Apostles' Creed. Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and that's who we focus on, is him. And through that, we have a credentialing process in our denomination for pastoring. First, there's a local license, which is issued by the local church and the pastor of that church, and then after some education requirements are met and some time in service, they move up to what's called a district license. And then the district eldership is credentialing our ministers, and they go to annual accountability meetings and interviews that take place for about 4 years after that, and then ordination takes place. And someone who is called to the ministry will finally be ordained, and that process of education in that way is complete. But we never stop learning, right? We always continue to be educated and to learn and to grow in Christ. But we had six pastors on staff plus myself. That makes seven, which isn't that just the perfect number? But then Pastor Chris got called away to serve at another church. But I have to tell you that we have three pastors in our church that received their district license this week. And, well, I say three minus the one, but here he is. Listen to this.
Hello, DHCC. This is Pastor Chris. I just wanted to send a quick video to say thank you. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for the last 7 years. My time there was needed. It was a time of growth. It was a time of faith and really learning to use the gifts and the talents that God has given me, as well as many other things that he's given to me in my life, to learn to pastor, to learn to preach, and to learn to just be a part of the church at the capacity that I needed to learn. And DHCC was that church and will continue to be. And I just want to thank you so much for that, for the friendships, for the family that I have there. And even though I'm not there anymore, I still feel like I'm part of the family and always will be. I thank you so much for the encouragements. I thank you so much for allowing me to grow. And as I now have my district license in the Church of the Nazarene, I am forever grateful for my time there. I know I'll see you again, I'm sure, and I'm hopeful that I'll be able to play and worship at the church from time to time, maybe have a sermon or two ready for you, but more than that, to be grateful in my heart always for what you mean to me as a family of God, but close to my heart for the time that you've given me. I'm very, very thankful, and I love each and every one of you so much. We'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
That was Pastor Chris. We all know and love him, and we talk on a weekly basis, and we're actually going to be doing ministry again next week up at camp meeting. We're going to be playing together on the worship team up there. So, well, I'd like to invite Pastor Trish and Pastor Fred to the stage, please. Would you come on up? Now, they already have their district license, so I don't have anything to give them. They received it from the district, and I just want you to know, if you don't know enough about these two individuals, but Trish, you've been with us now a couple years, right? Wow, just time flies, and she's been serving in multiple facets. Remember when COVID hit, she became a part of the emergency response team and was directing and helping us organize that during that time, and she's, many of you have accessed her through pastoral care, and she's obviously directing a therapy group for ladies that is just incredible. That I'm not allowed to be in that group, but I'm hearing incredible things about it, and thank you for covering Sunday school this month. Thank you for everything that you're doing, Pastor Trish, to serve the people of this church. We really, really appreciate you. Really appreciate you. And then there's this guy. Pastor Fred has been much like, oh, and, you know, I wanted to mention, not only is Pastor Trish completing her master's degree, but she's moving right into her doctorate, right into her PhD after this, so pray for her. That's a big challenge. But yeah, we're excited. She's going to be jumping right into that. And there's just a lot of neat things. God's opening up a lot of neat doors for Pastor Trish, and we'll see more to come. The best is yet to come. Pastor Fred is also fast-tracking to complete his bachelor's degree at Grand Canyon University. He's now a senior. Yeah. He's finishing up his last year, praise God. He's excited about that. And, you know, Casey, thank you for supporting, really putting up with this fella, but your support has been invaluable, I'm sure, to Fred. And we just thank you. He is our associate pastor. He also teaches discipleship Wednesday nights, part of our adult education ministries. And just pretty much anything I need from him, he is so ready and willing to serve. He has a servant's heart. And so, Fred, I'm grateful for all that you do for our church and our community. And for me as my associate pastor, you're invaluable to the ministry of this church and to myself. So thank you for all that you do, sir. Yeah. All right. Pastor Trish.
They decided to give me a mic again. So I just wanted to go over the announcements this morning. At first, I wanted to tell you all thank you. I appreciate the prayers for those of you that were on the Facebook prayer group. I was one of the many in our church right now that was kind of attacked physically, and the Lord really brought me through that. I was in the hospital this week, and here I am. So enemy's not going to get me down, right? We have several members, though, that are still at home, and they're still resting, and they're still recovering, and they're in a whole lot more pain than I was, and so just continue to pray for them. But I appreciate you, church, for praying for me. I could feel your prayers, and man, this is home for me. So if you're listening online or you're sitting in the congregation, you're part of my family, and I appreciate you. So I just wanted to go over these announcements really quick. We have camp meeting, as the pastor said earlier, July 15th through 18th. I'm not sure, can you even register for that still?
Yes.
You can.
Camppinerock.org.
I'm so disappointed. I don't get to go, but I will be here next Sunday. But I don't get to go this time. I cannot wait till next year because I'm going to go. I have heard tremendous things about camp meeting ever since I was a little girl. So growing up, all these wonderful things that happen and just this bonding time. So if you can go, if you can break away, please go to camp meeting. We have Teen Challenge service next Sunday. So Teen Challenge will be here. They'll be running the whole entire service. I will be bothering you every once in a while throughout the service, but they're going to be in charge. And then I don't want you to forget about our camp out. So the DHCC annual family camp out will be September 3rd through 6th, 3rd through 6th. And so you'll want to sign up for that if you're able to go to that. So let me go over the youth real quick. We have Wednesday, the 7th is already passed. The 14th, we have a pool party. It's free at Pastor Kristen's house from 6 to 8 p.m. Friday, the 16th, we are meeting at Main Event at 4 o'clock. The kids will be back here. By 10.
We're leaving here at 4 o'clock.
Oh, we're leaving at 4 o'clock.
Yeah, from here.
She should do this. No, it's okay. I can't be quite as, you know, she's got all the youth pastor stuff going on there. So anyway, so the 21st, it's called Among Us in the Alley.
Yeah, I know nothing about it. Ask John.
John knows these things. So John will be telling you that if you want to know more about that. Friday the 30th, Solid Rock Teen Center. And Wednesday the 28th, Worship and Prayer Night. And then that's all I'm going to go through. We have a bunch of stuff going on. Make sure you pick up these. Pick up your flyer. I want to mention to you really quick that this congregation, we would love for money to grow on trees, but it does not. And so we appreciate any of you that can continue your tithing through the summer. It gets a little tight. And so if you would like to give, if you're compelled to give, if you have not tithed yet this month, text any amount to 84321. I don't do that quite as fun as Fred does. We have tithe boxes in the back, and you can also go to dhccgive.com if you want to contribute that way. So let me just pray over you, and we'll get started with this worship service. Dear Lord, I just pray. So I just thank you, Lord, for so much for this home, for this church that I can call home, for this church that this congregation can call home. And we thank you, Lord God, that you that your presence is here. We invite your presence just to be among us today as we worship you and we learn more about what you would have us know about you, Lord, about our relationship with you, Lord God. I just pray that you just bless this service tremendously and help our hearts to be softened to your word. And I pray all of this in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand and worship this morning. This is a new song for us. Holy Spirit, rest on us in this place this morning. Amen. Moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit of the moon over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit is moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit Pause that for a second. I just want to pray right now. Lord, I just thank you that we can come into a place where we can just celebrate your name, that we can worship you. Lord, I just, we want to dedicate this moment to just truly worship you and express our gratitude from our hearts this morning. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we lift up your name. Hallelujah. Amen. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
A hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the midst of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear you lost your hold on me.
And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the hope will arise, and death is defeated, the King is alive.
Just raise your voices this morning as we raise a hallelujah to our King.
Sing a little louder.
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 Oh, sing a little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Come on, church, sing it. Sing a little louder.
In the presence of woo! My enemies.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies,
middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. And death is defeated, our King is alive. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
Can you hear me now? Okay, there it is. For those of you online, hear me, but great. So that's wonderful. No, I'm kidding. If you're online, you did not just buffer right now. That was Pastor just faking you out there. Sorry about that. Couldn't resist. Okay. Woo, a little hot in here. Church, pray for a drummer. Pray for a drummer, okay? We're going to be in Mark chapter 5 today, if you want to turn there. Thank you, Lord, for water. We are, amen. We're in our second week, just a mini-series. We're ending it today, just 2 weeks on. Remember. Sometimes we need to just remember. Sometimes we need to be reminded. You know, and I know we all, as believers, we're like, oh, God, you're so good. All the time and all the time, that was good. But sometimes we need to be reminded of how good he's been to you. Remember how good he was. And we did this last week. I want to do it again. Everybody, think of a time when the Lord just blessed your socks off, unexpected. He showed up or he provided in a way that was just so mind-blowing. You were just praising him, and it brought you closer to him. It was a transforming moment in your life. Maybe it was the point of your salvation. I don't know. Whatever it might be for you. Maybe you're struggling today, but you need to remember if God did it before, he can do it again. He will. I believe that because he's a good, good father. So we're going to go through a little bit of scripture here this morning. In fact, probably going to read through more verses than I typically would in any sermon, okay? So you're going to get your Bible reading in for this week right now, okay? And I got this up here, so maybe we'll get a little white hanky sermon going here. I don't know. Can I preach this morning? Can I preach, church? All right. Let's go to Mark chapter 5. We'll look at verse 21, Mark 5, 21, and then we'll land all the way to verse 43, when we're done here, okay? It says this, when Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter's dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him, and a woman was there who'd been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. Does that sound familiar? Anybody go through doctor after doctor after doctor until you finally, I know a couple people in here, yeah, been there. You see, the people crowded against you, his disciples, and yet you're going to sit up here and ask who touched me? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. So obviously the disciples are like, "You got to be kidding me. We're bumping elbows here. It's you're bumping into people all the time. You're being touched by people all the time." And no, Jesus is like, no. Who touched my clothes? Who intentionally, right? Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be free from your suffering." Amen. While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, one version says this: ignoring what they said, Jesus told him, interesting, "Don't be afraid, just believe. Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother James. And when they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and he said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? That girl is not dead. She's just asleep. They did what you did." They did what we would do, what any of us would do, right? They laughed. They laughed at him. And after he put them all out, this is my favorite part of the scripture, he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him and went out where the child was, took her by the head and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means little girl, "I say to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old, by the way, right? At this, they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this, and then told them, "Don't just stand there and look at the girl. Go get her something to eat real quick. Like Chick-fil-A. Go through Chick-fil-A. They love Jesus. Get her some Chick-fil-A, whatever, you know. And that would actually heal me. That would be enough with that sauce. End of story. I'm good." No, but at this, they were completely astonished, right? Giving strict orders, "Don't tell anybody, but get her something to eat. She's famished." She's famished, right? Now, when I read this story, I thought that the real climax of this miracle was obviously Jesus telling this little girl who was dead or asleep to get up. Upon further reflection, I realized that was premature, simply because of verses 40 and 41. I want us to hone in on those, okay? So zero in on verses 40 and 41. Because it says, "But they laughed at him." Who was the him? Jesus, right? They. Who was the they? the negative, doubting, unbelieving, faith leaving, 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 faith leaving.
Every solution, they will find a problem, right? And it says they laughed at him. It says after he, that's Jesus, put them all out.
Woo, Jesus put them out. In fact, the Greek says, the Greek suggests with that word, there's some studies say that he physically put them out. Like, get out of here. Grab him by the ear. Enough of that. Get out. You know, who knows? But Jesus ain't afraid of no gangster, right? He takes care of business like a boss. He's the Son of the living God. There's all those negative, doubting, unbelieving people who are messing up the atmosphere in that room. He's like, nope, y'all got to get out. Once they got out, then he went to the little girl and he said, get up. Get up, right? Church, what if the power of a miracle in your life is not just in the miracle itself, but rather it's in the atmosphere and the environment that surrounds that miracle? What if? Could it be possible that you've been looking at situations in your life and telling them to get up, but this is exactly the season of your life to start checking your environment and start telling things to get out? Oh, I'm going to be preaching up in here this morning. Come on. Come on. You got to tell some of this stuff, some of this negative energy, some of this enemy stuff to get out. Get out. Could it be possible that a miracle is waiting for us, but the environment's just not ready yet? Come on, somebody say, get out. Say it again, get out. That's what I want to preach about today, okay? So in our text today, Mark begins by talking about the synagogue leader, Jairus, right? But then he starts talking about this woman with the issue of blood. It's all tied in together. Interesting. The reason Mark has merged these two stories together is because the two of them are connected. They're connected. Why else would he? In fact, to talk about Jairus, the synagogue leader, he never discussed the woman with the issue of blood. It's really to do an injustice to this passage if we don't tie this in to the story of Jairus. The two are really deeply connected, and we'll talk about that. Not on the surface, perhaps. I mean, on the surface, it doesn't look so connected, right? If you look at the surface of their lives, they couldn't be more opposite, actually. When you look at the surface, one of these things is not like the other, right? And first of all, Jairus is a man. She's a woman. There's two big differences. Jairus is named in the text. You get his name. The Bible doesn't give us the name of this woman. Jairus is a ruler in the Jewish synagogue. This woman can't even come near the synagogue, right, because of her sickness. Her sickness has made her ceremonially, say that three times fast, ceremonially unclean. The culture would suggest Jairus is affluent, right? He's probably got some money in the bank. This woman's probably broke, busted, and disgusted, right? I mean, she said she spent all she had on doctors that couldn't help her, right? Worthless physicians. They actually made it worse, right? That's a malpractice suit right there. They're just completely opposite. They have absolutely nothing in common on the surface, but life has put them in the exact same place and position because they both had been hit with something that they knew they could not handle or take care of themselves. How many of you know life will do that to you? Amen? How many of you know life will do that? Life has a way of evening the playing field, if you will, or sometimes we feel like it's very unfair and uneven, but life has a way of hitting you upside the head with some very unexpected events. Some things that maybe your money can't fix. Some things your friends can't fix. Life has a way of sometimes just taking your breath away, and I don't mean in the positive sense. Life has a way of even making an atheist say, oh God, I need you right now. Hey, let's make a deal. Right? Life can hit you with things that you cannot handle. Remember, we went through that scripture, and many people think that it's talking about God won't give you anything that you can't handle, and that's not what the scripture says. Okay? So don't worry. You're a strong believer. If you're going through something and you raise your hands up and give up and you feel like you can't handle it, the scriptures actually, God will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you cannot have a way out of. Okay? Bible never says God won't give you more than you can handle. Okay? That's a misquoting of scripture. And if you don't believe me, do the research and we'll talk later, but it never says that. Trust me, there's a lot of things you can't handle. There's a lot of things I can never handle. Otherwise, if I could handle it, then I wouldn't need him. In steps Jesus. In steps Jesus, amen. So, just some things we can't handle. Some things we can't find any other resource to help. Right? Not in a job. Sometimes not in your money, your friends, right? So Jairus and this woman, nothing in common on the surface, but both ended up in the same position, having to push people out of the way to get to an appointment with Jesus. That's actually ironic, don't you think? A little too ironic, I really do think. See, neither one of them had a pretty pathway with rose petals to Jesus. But they both had to be inconvenienced and push people out of the way. Excuse me. Yeah, I know you were standing there, but I'm trying to get through. Can I get through here? Right. They both had to go through that to find Jesus. Pushing. You know why they're pushing? I'll tell you why they're pushing. They had to push to Jesus because desperate people do desperate things. How many of you know when you're desperate for God, you sort of approach God differently? You know what I mean? You get a little desperate, you approach him differently, right? When you're really desperate for God, oh, you don't care what other people think about you when you're lifting up your hands in worship. When you're desperate for God, you'll pray more every day. He will use tragedy to wake people up, right? He'll use these kinds of moments in our lives to wake us up from our lethargic attitudes, our apathy, our spiritual apathy, our Christian complacency. He'll wake you up. Sometimes he's waiting for you to get desperate for him. He's waiting for you to be desperate to see change in your life. Jesus is desperate for you to see change in your family, for you to want it, for you to be desperate, rather. Desperate generation. Or maybe it's just a generation of desperation. But I tell you, your own desperation, oh, it'll open up doors, right? The complacency keeps shut. There's something about being desperate. And I love that it was desperation that brought Jairus and this woman both at the feet of Jesus. Amen. Are you bored yet? Because I really want to get a little deeper. I want to delve into desperation. I know everybody here knows what that feels like. Jairus, he gets to Jesus first, and boy, he's desperate, man. He's desperate because his little girl, his little baby girl, man, she's dying. Her little 12-year-old girl is moments away from death. And when he gets to Jesus, yes 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 to Jesus.
And this woman has been dealing with the issue of bleeding They've both been dealing.
Well, the girl's 12 years old. The woman's been dealing with it for 12 years. So she's had this since this little girl was born. Maybe even the very day. Interesting. So that means, cinematically speaking, if Mark chapter 5 was a movie and the producers of This Is Us were making the movie, this is the scene where it would flash from the feet of Jesus and say 12 years earlier and go to a hospital, and walking out of that hospital would be Jairus and his wife, and they're holding their brand new little baby girl with that silly little new parent grin. And then perhaps walking out of that same hospital is this woman, and she's in tears. I mean, she's broken her face. She's just been diagnosed with a disease the doctors don't know what to do about. And just maybe they were in the same hospital that same day, who knows. But they couldn't have even known each other. Maybe they did pass by each other 12 years ago. Maybe they didn't, who knows. But isn't life like that? A little serendipitous here and there. Sometimes good, sometimes not so good. But that's like our lives today. We experience things that are sometimes seemingly bad, but God still has a plan. He still has a plan. I find that sometimes you can be so preoccupied with your promises or so preoccupied with your pain that you don't see other people around you. We tend to just walk past people that God may want to use you to be a blessing to. I don't care how good your promise. I don't care how bad your pain. Don't let it make you become oblivious to other people around you that God actually might use you to speak life, love, and truth into them. The Word of God. See, we've seen forgotten. We seem to have forgotten Romans chapter 12 that says you have to rejoice with those that rejoice and we weep with those who weep, right? Yeah, how many of you don't know that you don't need a Bible degree, right, to be a minister of the gospel, right? How many of you know that it's not just reserved for the pastors to do this kind of work, right? In fact, the Bible says the pastors are supposed to prepare the saints to do the work of the ministry, right? That's our job, is to prepare you, to teach into you, and to encourage you, and 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 encourage you, and
the New Testament life, and you know, our New Testament high priest is Jesus.
And the first time we see Jesus teaching in the temple, he's age 12. And they marveled, and how did this little junior kid, man, have so much power and wisdom, right? See, 12 is this big number to God. You know what 12 signifies in the Bible? It means God's power. It's the number of God's authority. So, do you know what Jesus is saying whenever you see 12? I got the power. I have the authority. I have the keys, right, to death and Hades, right? I have all authority in all heaven and all earth. Amen? Jesus. He's saying, I don't care what sickness, disease, calamity, or problem that is in your life. There's absolutely nothing you're facing that is not under my jurisdiction, my authority, my power, the power of 12. He's saying, through the 12, I have the power to handle whatever's coming against you. Oh, come on, church, that's good news. You should be waving your own hanky about that, about right now. Come on. Come on, church. Whew. That's good news. 12. That's why he called 12 disciples. See, if it was me, I probably would have stopped at number 11 and told Judas, you get the boot. Bye, hater, you know. I wouldn't call Judas. But Jesus, no, he calls all 12 and gave them the power and the authority to cast out demons and to heal every sickness and disease. Now, I know this number of 12 is so powerful, this number of authority. It's very, very important. It's important because sometimes it is your unawareness of God's authority in your life that will determine how much you receive. Sometimes, I'm not saying all the time, sometimes there might be these moments where maybe you're not grasping, maybe you're not totally comprehending the power of Jesus that surrounds you. And that limits you from receiving it all. I know that's a big statement, but I believe sometimes that could be true. Awareness of God's authority that will often determine how much of it you receive from Him. See, often we look at a passage like this and we reduce it to just faith. Because He said, daughter, your faith has healed you, right? And we know how faith is important. We know how important it is. We need faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. See, without faith, it's impossible. 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 Faith, it's right. See, once you get your faith to authority, then your faith will go to a whole nother level. See, but if you don't believe He's the ultimate authority, then your faith will struggle. It will struggle. Remember when Jesus calms the storm? Notice the disciples, they're in the boat, and the winds and the waves are going crazy, and they're panicking, right? They're having a panic attack. Just like in our culture today, man, we're seeing everything crash around us and there's panic attacks happening everywhere. And Jesus, what's He doing? He's down below at the bottom of the boat and He's sawing logs. He's snoring away. He's chillaxing. He is actually asleep during this storm. Mark even says he had his head on a pillow, okay? He's got a MyPillow.com. He's having the best rest. And I love those pillows. And disciples are like, Jesus, you don't care about us. You're just going to let us die. They're whining and complaining. Amazing. And Jesus gets up, cool, calm, and collected, man. Just goes up to the edge of the boat and says, peace, be still, right? And in a moment, the winds and the waves obey Him. Everything is calm. I mean, the disciples must have dropped their jaws, you know. Who is this man that even the winds and the waves obey Him? It's Jesus. And see, if Jesus ain't stressed about your situation, why should you? God is not in heaven having a panic attack right now over your situation. Jesus doesn't have anxiety, right? You can sleep at night and you can trust His authority. You may not have a faith problem. You might just not have the awareness of how much authority Jesus really has in your life. And I'm here to tell you this morning, it's 100%. It's everything. The Bible calls him Melech HaOlam in the Hebrew. He is king of the universe. Doesn't get any bigger than that, church. Jesus is king of the universe, and he cares for you. It's my earnest prayer that in the midst of this chaos and craziness in the world, that God would actually strengthen your faith, church, because you will get a fresh awareness of his authority when you begin to move and to grow in his faith. I mean, he has the final say. No matter what's going on, no matter how bad your situation is, Jesus has the final say. Just connect your faith to his authority and be aware. And then anticipate as Jesus will come on the scene and do what he does best. Can we go deeper? Jairus got a house call, basically, from Jesus, because that was his authority, or his awareness, rather, of Christ's authority. Don't forget, Jairus worked in the synagogue, okay? So he's basically a pastor or deacon. He approaches Jesus just like a pastor would and said, Jesus, sir, Jesus, please, could you come to my house? My daughter, she's about to die. I need you to come over. Jesus is like, yeah, cool. You want me to come over? I'll come to your house. I'll be right there. But this woman, oh, she had a whole other awareness of his authority, right? She's like, you don't need to come to my house. Right, I actually don't have time for that. I know you're out here. I got to get to you as fast as I can. I've been dealing with this way too long. All I got to do is touch the hem of your garment. And if I just touch the hem of your garment, I just know. I'm aware of your authority, Jesus. I just know I'm going to be healed. And she is. Wow. That's exactly what she got. And you know why? Because her awareness of her authority was there in the right place. Maybe faith's not really your problem. Maybe you just don't have the right awareness. Maybe it's not big enough. Maybe your problem seems bigger than his authority, and you need to understand there is no problem too big or too small for our God. I don't know. This might be a really important message for somebody this morning. See, if you don't believe that Jesus is the ultimate authority, I mean, if you don't understand and comprehend his authority, You'll doubt his validity. And we serve a God that says, I am the Word. If you don't believe somebody's the ultimate authority, you're going to doubt the validity of their words, right? Ever been there before? Ever been at a place of business and you walk in and you're greeted by someone and they let you know that you weren't really talking to the head honcho in the business. You know, you were talking to an employee. You weren't really talking to the boss. You could tell that maybe they didn't treat you just right. Maybe they're kind of rude or just unprofessional, and you know, you're talking to them, and maybe they even have the nerve to say something contradictory to what you were, you know, there for, whatever. But you're maybe you're one of those people that say, "Can I please speak to the manager?" Right? I don't know if that's you. I don't know if there's any Karens in here. Can I speak to the supervisor? I need to speak to, you know. Oh, unless you're super sanctified, you know, maybe then you would just turn the other cheek. I don't know. But I don't know what kind of person. But, you know, and it's okay to ask for the manager. I'm not saying it's not nice to ask, but you can ask for the manager because you know that person has the real authority. You're not going to mess around with anybody else. You know who right to go to, right? You go to the person in charge. Well, if you're so annoyed by being out, 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 by being out. I want to speak to the guy in charge. I want to speak to the God that has all authority. in all heaven and earth, who did something so awesome, so miraculous in my life years ago that I just need to remember he can do it again, church. He can do it again. Become aware of the authority of God and just connect your faith, tie it up right to it, and anchor yourself at the feet of Jesus with your desperation, with your pain, your worries, anxieties, and concerns. Don't forget to remember who we serve. Let's pray. So thankful for you this morning, Jesus. You are the God that spoke everything into existence. By just your words, you created all things. You breathed the breath of life into us, God. Redeemed us at the cross. Deposited your spirit within us and gave us a purpose to join you in the restoration of the world. To be a part of your body as the church. And then to one day live with you eternally in your presence. Hallelujah. Why would we ever doubt? How could we never understand and know how great and awesome your power and authority is, Jesus? I want that for my life. I want that for my life.
So it amazes me that all through Scripture we see how God connects us. And it came to me while I was listening to Pastor Todd, and it's almost lunchtime, that sometimes when we're hungry, right, we have desperation for food. How many of you have ever gone to like El Encanto Dos and they put those chips and salsa in front of you? And before you even have the opportunity to order food again, they're all gone, right? Because you're hungry. You have desperation for sustenance, to put something in your body that is going to sustain life. And sometimes that's what we need to do with Jesus. Not sometimes, all the time, right? Every day we need to be living a life that is desperate for more filling of Jesus. And when we live in that foundation and we're anchored in Jesus, then we constantly get filled. And that diversity that we find in the world around us, it doesn't matter anymore because we're so focused on him. And that allows us to remember, even in the hardest times, that he will do miraculous things again and again and again. And for some of us who are really struggling right now, sometimes that again is just taking another inhale and another exhale. And sometimes that inhale is like, God, I need more of you. And the exhale is, enemy, flee from me. Jesus, I need more of you. Enemy, flee from me. Right? When we sing praises, the enemy has no option but to flee.
Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your
from hearing the word of God, that's how we build faith. And during this sermon, we got to see two different forms of great expectation in the authority of God, didn't we? We got to see one form where the great expectation of God's authority to heal somebody else. And then we got to see the great expectation of God's authority to heal themselves. See, so we got to see two different kinds of expectation of hope in this sermon. And therefore, that's encouraging to me because now See, because of this, and I see God's faithfulness, that I can live in the hope of future glory because of what God did in the past. Amen? And so, if we live in great expectations today, Lord, let's say as one voice, Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. And so, Lord, as we gather the body of Christ, whether present or abroad, we offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, on these, your gifts. Make them by the power of your Spirit to be for us redemption through the blood and body and blood of Jesus Christ, and that we may be for the world a part of the redemptive plan through his church. On the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body that's been poured out, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you, preserves you blameless until everlasting life. Eat this in remembrance that Christ has died for you, and let's be thankful. Let's partake as one body. Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which has been poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you preserves you blameless until everlasting life. Drink in remembrance that Christ died for you. And let us be thankful. Let's partake as one body." So, Lord, we praise and we thank you for your faithfulness in all of our lives. Lord, and I just pray that you take these ordinary elements and make them extraordinary in each and every one of us. And we thank you, Jesus. And in your mighty and precious name, amen.
All right, folks. Have you been blessed today? I've been blessed. Yeah. Three things that really God has put on my heart through this sermon that I just want to share with you. I was really looking at, like, if Jesus is giving the authority to someone who he knows is going to disconnect from him in Judas, how much more can Jesus do through me if I stay connected? Like, how cool is that? The second thing that really came up for me was this question of who or what do I need to kick out so that I can have an environment where I can show up and be present for the miracles that are happening in my life. And that's a challenge that I want to throw out to y'all, because the miracles are happening. They're happening. We have to be present for them. And so who can we or what can we kick out of our environment so that we can be there for what the Lord is doing? And the third one is, who or what have I given authority to over the ultimate authority in my life? And that's something to just explore. Who or what have I given power to in my life when Jesus is the ultimate authority? And he is for me. He is for you. So who else to give authority to than someone who is for us? Not everything or everyone we give power to is for us, y'all. So we are transitioning into a time of tithe. Speaking of authority and who has the ultimate authority of our finances, y'all, there are multiple ways to give. So you can text any amount to 84321. You can use the tithe boxes, and you can also go to dhccgive.com. So I want to leave you with this blessing. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace, I pray. Amen. Go and be blessed, church.